I wanted to give you first an opportunity. It was a very brief conversation with the Premier Prentice, but if there was anything that he said that you wanted to either argue with, which would be great, or aggressively agree with. So was there anything in the information that we covered there on energy before we go on to your particular sectors?
No, I'll
start with you.
Yeah, I was in violent disagreement with him.
Okay.
And I think, quite frankly, he's a very welcome entrant into the debate. He's probably done more in the last few weeks to help calm troubled waters than we've seen in some time.
No, I wouldn't disagree with Jim Prentice. I think he's done something very important. He's started the conversation. I mean, there's a conversation that needs to be had around these infrastructure projects, especially energy east. So that conversation started, and it appears to be started on the right track.
Okay, well, we'll come back to the pipelines. Ellis Ross, you don't have to say anything if you don't have
good.
Yeah?
Good. That's
okay.
Fine by me.
Okay, we'll go on.
Carry on.
But I will come back to you.
Yes. Well, I think the first thing I'd agree with him is go stamps go, Calgary Stampeders. We've been waiting for that for a long time. So showing my Calgarian pride today. I guess the thing that I think the important question to ask as far as access to markets, particularly pipelines, is not the question, will they be built? Of course, over time, that access to market will happen. The question is, when will it be built? And when will the market pressures and the demands cause those, whether it's east, west, or south, or off the tidewaters of North America, it will eventually happen. It's the question is when.
He's very confident, and you seem very confident about that, but I can think of three words, Mackenzie Valley Pipeline, that everyone thought that would be built, that it would make a lot of sense. It's proposed in the late 1970s. So, I mean, why are you so optimistic that that's going to happen?
Well, if you look at the, all the analysts says that we need energy, and that energy requirement is growing over the next two decades. You know, energy is going to increase somewhere around 30% by 2035. Natural gas is going to increase. We know that through all the analysis that coal, natural gas, crude is going to be the large part of that energy demand over the next 30, 40 years. And so its time is there. The question is when. So McKenzie Pipeline, its time is not yet, but someday it will.
Well, seeing as we are talking pipelines, Mr. McKenna, I know that you've been a big proponent, maybe the first person to even propose the Energy East or something like that. So what do you think is holding it up right now, or is it being held up?
No, I don't think it's being held up at all. It's going through some normal hitches, and there's a bit of a fight en famille between the LDCs and the carrier that I think I'd like to see taken off the four-lane highway and moved into a parking lot to be settled, quite frankly, through arbitration or through some private mechanism. I don't know what, but I think that the pipeline makes a lot of sense, which is why I'm quite confident about it. First of all, it's very good for Western Canada, but it's also very good for Central Canada. It feeds a number of refineries en route, which is unlike almost every other pipeline that's being proposed. There's 680,000 barrels of imported oil coming in to Eastern Canada from some pretty dodgy places around the world and at Brent prices. So there's been a big arbitrage on prices that's been to our disadvantage. So you end up refineries that may have been marginal now will have access to competitive prices. That's a good thing. You're actually moving oil in a pipeline that will be used in Canada. That's a good thing. And it gets to tidal water in St. John, New Brunswick, in a port that handles 400 tankers a year. The biggest tankers in the world can go there year-round, ice-free port. And you're six or seven sailing days closer to India, closer to Europe, and closer to the Gulf. So I think for a lot of reasons, it makes a lot of sense, and I think sanity will prevail.
Okay. I want to shift on to hydro, because it's a part of the energy equation that I shouldn't say we never talk about it, but we don't talk about it enough in Canada. And I know Hydro-Québec is both a large provider and a large exporter. I'm curious to know what the recent developments in the energy world, and I'm thinking with all of the energy coming on stream in the U.S. and then the drop in the price of oil, how does that sort of impact your world?
Well, so, I mean, obviously, we do better if gas prices are higher, to the extent that a lot of gas gets used to produce power. But at the same time, what's happening in the U.S., which is very good, I think, obviously, for Hydro-Québec, but I think good for Canada in generally, is that there's a very, very significant displacement taking place right now of gas in the place of coal. I mean, American coal is going overseas to, you know, places like Germany, for example, which is a little strange, but... But still, coal generation, coal power generation is coming down, and a lot of gas is taking that place. The nuclear renaissance is basically has been stopped in the U.S. So, I mean, it is freeing up an interesting space for renewables, and obviously hydro is a big part of the renewable space. So, I mean, we're seeing, you know, tremendous potential. We're seeing market conditions which are really interesting. We're pushing. We talk a lot about pipelines in Canada, but there's a lot of transmission lines, also power transmission lines. We've got power transmission line projects into New England, into New York, and those are very, very important pieces of infrastructure also. So it's what's going on in the U.S. is creating some opportunities if you look at the long term.
Right. Okay. Okay. Mr. Ross, how about you? We were talking before about the changing dynamics of the energy market, and I'm curious to know if it is impacting your view of things and your world and the projects that you're looking at.
No. You know, this is a fascinating topic, the energy equation, whether you're talking international or national. Unfortunately, in BC, Aboriginals aren't ready for that topic. I mean, I love talking about the export to Asia and energy and hydro, but at the same time, I look around me, that's happening in my region with my neighbors, and they're not ready for that talk. They're still talking about engagement, inclusion. And now that industry and government have been forced to include First Nations, you gotta remember, First Nations have been fighting for 40 years to be included. So in 40 years, they haven't been building capacity. They've been fighting. Now that the fight's almost over, now they gotta sit back and say, okay, now how do I engage? How do I look at the economics? Where do I get legal help, corporate help? So these are all good questions, but at the same time, you gotta remember, these guys are just starting to get, if Haisla's at stage 7 of a 10-step process, a lot of these other First Nations are step 1. And I think that's probably the elephant in the room here when we're talking about energy exports. Fundamentally, you've gotta solve the Aboriginal question. I don't know what it's like back east. I have a pretty good idea of what it's like in Alberta, but BC is basically undefined. And I think our job as First Nations government industry is start to sit back and define those fundamental first steps on what it means to engage and build capacity and build knowledge. And then we can start having the energy equation topics with First Nations.
I noticed there's been an awful lot of talk among various levels of government about the need to have better relationship with the First Nations. Both at the federal level, where ministers have been going out and doing more meetings, and at the provincial level, but I'm wondering, is it any different than what's happened in the past? Like, do you think that it is a more constructive way to develop better relations on these energy matters?
There is, but it has to evolve. And it's over 10 years I've been at this job, all those processes to engage and talk, I don't want to see that happen again. Like just talking, just for the sake of talking. Don't want that. I want practical solutions to what the issues are. BC, the governments on the ground have a better idea how to do this. And I think the idea that it's industry's job to do it or government's job to do it, no, it's not. It's a tripartite exercise that has to happen. First Nations got to come to the table willingly, openly. Government and industry have to go, yeah, we can carve off components of it, and each entity can take on the responsibility of delivering a component, but really it's got to be I think it's got to be in the truest sense of reconciliation. We got to meet in the middle. And I do believe economics is a big part of that, but I also think that there's other areas that we should be looking at as well.
I think some of the members of the audience don't realize about where you're situated and the talk of an LNG project there. And I'm wondering if you could just say a few words about that and also your partnership with Chevron.
One of the partnerships we have with the industry is Chevron. And we're developing a partnership with Shell for the same type of industry. We've got a smaller project there. And it's everything I've talked about to date about capacity and the willingness to include and be included. And I'm really serious about the idea of capacity in terms of Haisla being at step 7 out of a 10-step process, but our neighbors are at step 1 and step 2. If you notice, we're not protesting. We're not blockading roads and like that. We're not doing any of that. In fact, if anything, I'm not talking about engagement. By the way, if you come to my office and you want to sing and dance and prayer or expect me to do the same, you better go down the road and find somebody else. I'm not going to do it. I want to talk about business. I want to talk about employment. I want to talk about training. So in terms of where we've gotten to next, is the reason why you don't see us out there protesting is because partly I'm supporting and lobbying for the natural gas industry. And I'm not talking about, you know, more employment or that. I'm going there to lobby for better tax policies. You got to change your emissions policies. Hey, your training program sucks. You got to do this and this and this. It's a totally different dynamic from what we were complaining about 20 years ago. And that's what happens when you get the fundamental steps taken care of right off the bat. Mind you, 10 years ago when we got engaged with these guys, we were just trying to find out how to engage and what we really wanted. Two things I tell First Nations when they want to engage, I guess, apart from all the rhetoric and the speeches and everything else, is two things they got to know. What is it that you want and who leads you? And I think for the most part for Haisla, we have answered those questions. It's not a question of wanting natural gas or crude oil or hydro or... It's about at the basic levels, what are we trying to solve? And maybe that's what we take in when we engage with companies like Chevron. It does change the relationship. It turns it right around. And I think that's the truest sense of the partnership that we formed with companies like Chevron.
Well, we should ask for the other side of this partnership then. Are there tips you could give or that you'd want to give to other energy companies on having a meaningful relationship, constructive relationship with First Nations?
So we've been in the relationship for only 2 years. I mean, the relationship started well ahead of where Chevron joined the project. But when you look at, you know, at least the employees that I represent, the 62,000 around the world, and all the retirees and the folks who are before us, really all that we have as an organization is human capacity. We have intellect, innovation, and ways to take a resource and create it into value and good for economy, for regions, and for societies. And so we know we're invited into someone's lands to do that, whether that's in Kuwait, whether that is in Indonesia, or whether that's in the territorial lands of the Haisla Nation as well. We know we are there by invitation. And so what we've learned from our predecessors is to, one, respect that heritage, those needs, understand and to partner with those areas, because as we create business in those areas, that becomes our home, because our employees live, our employees' kids grow up in those same areas. So we need to understand the needs of that area, whether it is the First Nations, the community. And so that was a conversation that started well ahead of Chevron. But our first meeting, meeting with Chief Ross and his council and his chiefs, was, you know, what are the needs? What are the issues that we need to understand? What are the values and the principles by which we earn the right to partner with you in these lands and hold us to a very high standard and expect us to deliver on that?
I'd like to ask all of you the same question that I asked Premier Prentice about the China-U.S. Climate agreement. I realize that it's nebulous, but it certainly has been interpreted in many quarters as showing that at least those two countries are more serious about getting involved in a deal next year, and that this puts pressure on Canada to get more serious about its climate change program. I'm wondering, what effect do you think that has on your piece of the energy industry? And I'll start with you, Mr. McKenna.
Well, I think what the two parties agreed to was significant. Some people depreciate China's commitment, but China's commitment is being driven by need. If you go to the Chinese cities, a lot of people here have, you can hardly see out the window, and they've got a problem. They have to fix it, and they're currently on schedule to double their coal capacity by 2030. So they're the leaders in the world in new technologies in renewables, but they're also the world leader in coal. And it's increasing. So they've got a big problem, and they know it. In the United States, I think the president is seized with this. I'm not sure that he'll have Congress as seized. So enough for that's by way of background. I personally believe that it is influential to our country, and I think that the fact that we don't have a climate change policy as a country, or greenhouse gas emissions policy as a country, it does erode our credibility somewhat in our attempt to access markets around the world. It's obvious that it has with respect to the United States. We don't have the moral high ground, let's put it that way. We may have market arguments to access other parts of the world, but I don't think that we have moral high ground. And I just loved Premier Prentice talking about Alberta being a leader in environmental technologies. I think that's a better face to give to the world. So I'm hoping that this will be influential, quite frankly.
Can I just follow that up and ask whether or not there was a point at which it becomes too late to try to change Canada's image on that?
No, I don't think so. I think the world would welcome Canada, quite frankly. I think the world is quite surprised that we're an outlier now, and they would welcome us. So I would like us to deal with that, because quite frankly, I think the quicker that we deal with this enormous vaporization of Canadian wealth, the better. The Premier alluded to the numbers, but over 20 years, we will destroy wealth to the tune of something like $1.3 trillion of GDP, $275 billion in the hands of government. This is not, and that's what's so frustrating for me, this is not an issue for carriers and for producers, pumpers, and everybody else. This is an issue for every Canadian who values our nurses and our doctors and our high quality of health care and income support and income distribution. All of that money is available to us for these very good societal things. But right now, we're shipping it by tanker car south to the United States of America. They are the ones that are taking advantage of our inability to access world markets. And it's not just money that lies around waiting for somebody to grab it. It is now 98% of all of our production goes to the United States of America. So they are the winners. We are the losers. And if Canadians, I think, as individuals, were seized with that knowledge, they'd say, this is a stupid idea. Why don't we do something about it?
Okay.
Coming back to your question, yeah, obviously it is a watershed event for this year, clearly. I mean, you look at the China situation. We have a business in China where we produce with Chinese partners electric motors, very large, very sophisticated electric motors for electric buses. I mean, they're not doing this because it's cheaper to have electric buses than diesel buses. They're doing it because there is a very serious environmental issue that they decided to deal with. So, I mean, it clearly they're moving. The U.S. is moving. In the power business, EPA is moving. The Environmental Protection Agency is moving very diligently towards regulation, which is going to change the landscape of power generation in the U.S. And I think coming back to Canada, I mean, this conversation around Energy East, I can tell you, in Quebec would be a lot easier if there was a framework in Canada around greenhouse gas, climate change, if there was a story around greenhouse gas and how, you know, we're going to get our act together and we're going to join the Party of Nations around this, and how pipelines and other infrastructures fit into this story. That would be a lot easier to move this forward in Quebec, at least.
Mr. Ross, you mentioned emissions before, but I'm wondering, in the conversations between the energy industry and First Nations, How big a part is the fact that we don't have, that Canada doesn't have a particularly good climate change policy, and how big a part are other things like territorial inclusion and things like that? Like, if Canada did have a better climate change policy, would that ease the way with discussions with First Nations, do you think?
I doubt it. No. Not unless the First Nation in question had the interest to study the emissions policy regionally or nationally, right. Which I don't see.
No.
It's really hard, you know. The idea that First Nations get included just like that is a mistake. I mean, it really, Canada's a victim of its own mechanisms for the most part. You isolate, you segregate an entity like this for so long, you segregate them into reserves, and then you're forced by the courts to include them. You know, that there's going to be a lot of mistrust there. So these First Nations have learned just to stick to their own issues, and that's it. They're not looking at the bigger issues, whereas 10 years of doing this now, we're starting to look at emissions coming out of the region, provincially, nationally. But we're also starting to look at why we got to look at emissions globally. I mean, you look at an issue, say, with what Asia's going through, and when I went there, the first thing I came back to tell my people was that it doesn't matter what we decide to do as First Nations or BC or Canada with energy. It doesn't matter. China's going to get its energy. And everybody saw Fukushima. Everybody saw the idea that you couldn't see across this room because of the haze that's in Asia. Well, if we don't get them a cleaner energy source, it's going to get worse. Yep. You can't stop the demand. China is building cities with the idea of bringing in 200 million people per year to the urban settings. That is just incredible. So natural gas, yeah. Canada, if you can get natural gas over to Asia, you can make a dent in the energy needs of Asia. But if you don't make that effort, they're going to go after coal, oil, diesel, nuclear. And I think that's what Canada's got to wake up to, that the emissions issue is just not regionally or provincially or nationally. It's a worldwide problem. Anything you do now can only help.
Could I just go down the group here and see, in terms of doing a policy, do you favor regulations or a carbon tax? And I may know this, but you may have been on the record on this, but let me hear it anyhow, Ms. McKenna.
Well, the challenge is doing anything in isolation, and I say that because we live right next door to the United States of America. They're our biggest friend, but biggest competitor as well. Ideally, we would introduce a climate change policy with the United States of America. And it has to involve carbon pricing in some way or other so that the right incentives and disincentives are created.
Mm. But you don't have any particular, you don't favor one over the other?
What I think is not very important, but I think the simplest mechanism by far is a carbon tax, which rewards you for reducing those things which we don't want, but that's revenue neutral and that similar to BC, where the money flows right back to the public, and I think that's the simplest solution. Whether that's politically feasible is another question, and whether ultimately it gets the better results. But I think it's the simplest mechanism by far.
Right. You're so far down there that I'm not asking you enough questions.
Yeah, but I'd like have to you hear got his answer too. On
yes.
So, I guess much like we were talking about emissions, and the atmosphere does not respect borders. It is it's a global atmosphere. And so you've got to really address it from a global perspective, which many of us were speaking about. Now, mechanically, that's quite difficult to manage that. And so when I asked the other question on free market, so how could we let free market judge and us as consumers of energy or resources make those choices? You know, we've experimented in different places in the utility sector on different things. And so I can put a personal value to me on reduced carbon for a energy source. And so, but there is a cost or a value to that. On the opposite side of that equation is we've got to let all energy energy sources play the game equally. So make sure that there aren't subsidies on other sides of that and let them compete. I think when we do that, we'll see that that innovation is really there. We will become more efficient in some of the new evolving alternate evolving energies, whether that's wind, solar, which currently aren't competitive with hydrocarbon sources, but it will drive that innovation for them to compete, as well as give that innovation with the hydrocarbon sector as well to reduce their emissions and be more efficient with their energy sources as well.
Okay. Mr. Vandal?
I think Frank has pretty much covered what I was said. The carbon tax is obviously simpler, but unlikely to go that route. Certainly the U.S. is not going that route.
Right.
So I think we're going to track towards more of a sector-by-sector approach, which is fine. I mean, we just do something.
Right. Okay. I think now I'm going to open it up to the audience, because I suspect you have more pointed questions and broader questions than I have. So are there questions? This is a very wide-ranging panel here on energy. Do we have some questions from the room for any of our panelists? The gentleman here.
I'm sorry for asking too many questions, but no one else had their hand up. John West, thank you for a fascinating session. It's striking there's no one here from wind or solar. You know, Canada, I would have thought, had a comparative advantage in wind and solar, and there is quite a bit around. Can the panelists perhaps offer a few comments on other renewable energies?
Maybe.
Yes, please do.
I don't think that Canada has a competitive advantage in solar. I mean, anyway, it's a question of latitude. And we're blessed in Canada, certainly in Quebec and Manitoba and in the Maritimes, et cetera. We're blessed in BC, obviously. We're blessed with good water, rainfall, snow, and that, you know, is very conducive to what is today still the largest and greatest renewable energy, which is hydro. Solar in Canada is it's going to be a very heavily subsidized thing. I mean, you know, solar in the U.S. is a niche play, you know, if you're in California and you're doing it under the radar. But what's happening is you're doing it under the radar and you're not paying for full cost. You're getting essentially a free ride on the grid, so that, you know, the grid is there, and you know you're attaching solar panels to that grid, but you're still counting on that grid, but you're not paying for that grid. So there is an issue developing in the U.S. around solar. Wind, the resource, it's you know, certainly mid-continent, and you know, Texas, Oklahoma has great resource. There are some regions in Canada that have it, but again, I wouldn't say that Canada has a huge advantage in terms of wind. The wind, the quality of the wind resource. We have great hydro, and we can certainly build, as we have, you know, certainly in Quebec and elsewhere, we can add other renewables like wind and biomass to that. But, you know, if you look at our topography or geography, we still have, it's very much a hydro-centric one.
Thank
and
you.
And there's still quite a bit more that we can do in that area.
I may add a little bit of context. While Chevron, it may be viewed as an oil and natural gas company, we're really an energy company, and we're one of the largest geothermal producers in the world with our geothermal business, as well as we're large investors in solar technology with wind, as well as biofuels. We've been evaluating biofuels as well. Because the fact is, we need all energy sources. Our children and our grandchildren will need all of those energy sources, including efficiencies and substantial efficiencies in all of our energy sources as well. So we're big investors, but it's really going to have to be as far as efficiency and being cost competitive with all the sources of energy around the globe.
Right. There was the gentleman at the back there. Yes?
Thank you. Hi, my name's Chris McDonald. I'm director of the Ted Rogers Leadership Center at Ryerson, just up the street. So a question about leadership. We know that in terms of energy, Canada has a leadership role to play in terms of output, in terms of volume, in terms of natural resources. We also know that we're not leading in terms of the environment. We're not leading in terms of relationship with our First Nations. Where can Canadians look to when they want to think about the leadership role that we play in the energy sector globally? Is there something we can look to that's not just about the outputs, but in about how it is we do it? Is there some aspect of this where we can play a leadership role?
Who'd like to take that?
I would challenge you, and with due respect for my colleague here from the West, and I'm not as familiar with the certainly situation out West, but I would challenge you in terms of leadership role around engagement with First Nations. And certainly, if you know a bit of the history of Hydro-Québec, we had a very, very tough, and we had to learn from that process. And it really started, you know, about 15, 20 years ago by going back and really sitting down, taking a hell of a lot of time listening to the Cree, great Cree leadership, the Cree elders, the trappers, the tallyman, spending a lot of time. I can tell you, I spent a hell of a lot of time just sitting there and listening. Not talking, just listening. And from that, deriving an understanding of how we could get on a road together to do renewable energy and the hydro in our case. And it's been successful. I mean, we've just, you know, we're in the process. We got, what, $17 billion under construction. We've completed some large hydro. The Cree are with it. The Cree are actually, you know, going internationally, telling that story to the United Nations, et cetera. And we're together in doing that. So, I mean, there has been success, but it's success that came after a very, very difficult period and having to learn from that. In terms of environmental stewardship, I think Canada is still both, you know, on the renewable side, but also in other areas, has some tremendous technology and can certainly show the way in terms of how we move power, how we move energy around in terms of technologies. So I think there's perhaps it's not a story we tell enough that we share enough, but I think there's very interesting elements to the story in Canada around leadership and energy.
Would you like to chime in there?
Well, I'm only going to answer this question because I don't have to stand for re-election again in any forum, so I can probably say what I want within some limits. But I think that leadership on energy in Canada is a big question mark, if I can be blunt. Primary constitutional authority for interprovincial pipelines is federal. Primary constitutional authority for First Nations is federal. I would say a paramount constitutional authority on environmental issues is federal. Provinces have jurisdiction, but if you're looking for a national greenhouse gas emissions or climate policy, it's federal. And who is absent on all of those files? Federal government. And quite frankly, vacuums are filled. And right now we've got provincial premiers in Quebec and Ontario weighing in the absence of other leadership. And Jim Prentice is replacing some of that leadership with his work. And you see this all across the country. My point is that there was a time in the country, and I think it would be a good time to return to, when premiers, prime ministers, First Nations used to meet in Congress and work on problems. If a premier in Western Canada is having trouble with salmon, the fishing rules, we would have a first minister's meeting and actually talk about that and try to figure out how we could all work together in solving that problem. Because at the end of the day, this is a country. It's not a collection of provinces. I was always proud to be premier of the province of New Brunswick, but there wasn't a day go by when I wouldn't say New Brunswick, I'm a Canadian first. And at some stage, we cannot run this country if it's balkanized into a collection of provinces that want to set up tolls at every provincial border. And so if I had a prayer here, it's that we have more leadership at the national level with all of the communities across the country working together and talking together.
Would you take that as far? Oh, there you go. Would you take that as far as having all of those people come together and try to work out a national energy strategy?
I think that concept is a good concept, the dialogue on a national energy strategy. At the very minimum, explaining to people what the stakes are here and trying to find out, can we, you've got a problem, can we deal with your problem. How can we address your problem? When people talk, a lot of things get fixed. If you don't talk, it's pretty hard to fix things. And by the way, a model of talking is Hydro-Québec and the work that you did, I think, with the Cree Nation and others in finding social license in the big projects that you've undertaken, the biggest projects in the country.
Hi, my name is Brahim Mahmoud. I am actually a journalist for L'Express. I was wondering about all the climate change aspect and other, you know, issues. How do you see the ISDS investor state deal issue regarding FIPA or CETA with the European Union? Well, as we are talking about environment, how do you see this issue? Thank you.
Can I just ask for clarification there? Are you asking that specifically about energy or just about the trade deal itself?
The trade deal itself, and as we are talking about environment, I will be very interested to see how do you see this issue?
Right.
ISDS, sorry for my pronunciation, I have since 3 months only. Thank you.
The investor dispute mechanism contained in it. Would anyone like to take that on?
No.
Come on.
Chief, over to you, Chief.
No, he doesn't want to take it. Would you like to take it on? No? No? Okay, no. I think the panelists will have to think about that a little, and we'll come back to it. Have we got any other? Yes?
Mr. Ross, you were very honest and forthright about your opinions about the difference between the different organizations. Being realistic, how long do you see everybody come to your state, which you said is a 7 or 8, with goodwill, if that would happen?
It could happen very quickly if best practices were laid down for every First Nation to understand and for all the industry and government to understand. The companies that come to me to ask me for advice on how to get through to First Nations, I give them 2 pieces of advice. And for the ones that follow this to a T, get their projects to environmental certificate very quickly, very surprisingly for me. And I don't charge them, which is my mistake. But the 2 things I tell them is research 2 areas first of all. Research the treatment of First Nations in Canada, because it's an ugly story. But it's mainly why the First Nations are acting the way they are. They don't trust anybody, including other First Nations. If anything, they detest their neighboring nations. So research all that. Next, research their current conditions. And if you can go online, there's a website that's going to be announced here within the next month that shows a database of all the agreements that First Nations have signed that are public domain. It gives you good insight into what types of agreements these First Nations are open to. So research, their culture, their political structure, hereditary leadership, political leadership. All this gives you an idea of how to go in and talk to them, and you're not prone to insulting them. By the way, don't go in with your FID in hand. Object your final investment decision. Don't go in saying, look at all the jobs, look at all the benefits, wow, look at it, you should sign. That's an insult. There was one thing said here, that you do your research right and you broach the subject respectfully with the First Nation, the next thing you should do is listen. I've been in meetings with companies where they talk about FID, employment, blah, 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 and I tell them what my issues are, and they go right back to their FID. You've basically shut off your communication. Now they'll go back to the government and play the governmental game, the referral game, the environmental assessment game. Your project is locked up until you go back and fix your mistake. Just sit down and listen. It'll take you, if you've done your research right, it should take you no more than 2 weeks. Let the conversation evolve naturally. Understand what their issues are and where you can fill that gap somehow. If you do it right, these First Nations then become your supporters or lobbyists. They champion your project for you. And these guys will do it singularly. There'll be no attachments like any lobbyist group beside them that's actually trying to stop your project, if you know what I mean. I know it's painful, but you got to start working these into your business plans, your timelines, your expenses. The only thing I'd wish on top of this is that the governments would actually make this as part of your project description so that you get some sort of a break in recognition of the work you're doing or the benefits that you're giving off to these First Nations, tax benefit, anything else. Those are two main areas that I advise everybody. If you get to that stage and the First Nation wants to talk more, there's some definitive next steps you can do to actually get their 100% commitment and involvement in your project.